This is RTE FM3 Classical Radio. And now, Aspects of Opera, in which Ted Courtney explores your favorite operas.
Good evening, and you're all very welcome to Aspects of Opera. And tonight's opera is Tannhauser by Wagner, produced in Dresden in 1845. The principal characters are Hermann, the Landgrave of Thuringia, bass, Tannhauser, a knight, tenor, Wolfram, his friend, baritone, Elizabeth, niece of Landgrave soprano, and Venus, soprano. So let's now enjoy part of the overture and what will later become the Pilgrim's Chorus. Now listen to the melody in the brass, especially to the restatement of that melody as the strings weep, yes, cry in downward sweeps against the melody. For Wagner, opera was music drama, a form in which the acted story was more important than the music. Tannhäuser was written when he was trying to find, in practice, a true balance between these two elements. Now, we must remember that after the first performance of this opera, Wagner almost despaired. The performers of the day seemed to be very wooden, if I may use that term. In fact, they couldn't bring out the dramatic effects necessary for the success of the opera. Later he wrote instructions as to how the work should be given, and these he called the performing of Tannhauser. Now, let's listen to the second part of the overture, and it suggests the glorification of Venus. Venusberg is where we find ourselves, and it's supposed to be the dwelling place of Venus and her nymphs. Now, you do, of course, know that Venus is the goddess of love, and all sorts of very naughty things go on between the denizens of Venusberg. I don't wish to go into details, but Aubrey Beardsley, in his book Under the Hill, does. So let's listen to the glorification of Venus. Listen out especially for lyrical clarinet against playful violin. Not much imagination required here. The similarity between Tannhäuser and Usheen in Tirnanoog is irresistible, to me anyway. Remember Niafkinoor takes him away on a white horse, but he misses home, just as Tannhäuser does. And he tells Venus, who chides him, by the way, this is Thuringia and Germany in the 13th century. Don't forget, this is Bach's home territory as well, sacred ground. Anyway, with a little difficulty, he tears himself away, but not before delivering himself of this beautiful aria, praising Venus, thanking her and asking to leave. As I said, she replies by chiding him, but he repeats the aria, this time a little more passionately. But the goddess is not to be moved. She lays a sort of curse on him and vanishes to the call of a clarinet. Now, musically, do you remember your first piano duet? The bass played a constant melody of so, mi, do, re, bum, 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 and repeated that figure over and over with a melody on top. Well, here Wagner does exactly the same in his intro, and with a melody you're well familiar with now, harp foremost.
Thank you.
And away she goes at the sound of the clarinet. At last he tears himself away. It is springtime when he arrives home. He prays at a wayside shrine for forgiveness. Unlike Oisin, he does meet his friends, and they welcome him back, in spite of his haughtiness when he left them. Among these is Landgrave of Thuringia and Wolfram. The Landgrave has a pure and beautiful niece, Elizabeth, and Wolfram loves her. Sadly for him, she loves Tannhauser. Before his departure a year earlier, Tannhauser had been one of Elizabeth's privileged friends. I suppose Tannhauser, wishing to be forgiven for his sins with Venus, feels that now he must do penance by wandering homeless and without rest. His friends welcome him and try to persuade him to go with them. Wolfram, who's a nice guy, but nice guys go nowhere in opera, tells him that since Tannhauser left, Elizabeth had been pining for him. And she'd been staying away from contests of song, which she loved so much. At last, Tannhauser decides to go back with them and to Elizabeth. He is joyfully greeted by the Lady Elizabeth. A contest of song is announced to celebrate Tannhauser's return, and the guests are received by the Landgrave and Elizabeth to the music of the processional march. The splendid fanfare gives way to a very sustained melody, broad and rich textured. A hallmark of romanticism.
Thank you.
the Landgrave announces that the theme of the songs shall be love. Let the battle commence. And the winner of the contest shall be able to claim Elizabeth, knowing full well, of course, that Tannhauser is the best singer. The Landgrave suggests that the song Tannhauser will sing may reveal why he went away. In a very startling way, this does happen. Tannhauser forgets all present and sings ecstatically, not of love, but in praise of mere desire. His audience is astonished. Remember the Germans' high-minded purity I spoke of that some weeks ago? Now they're really shocked by the exaltation of Venus and her love. This is too much for the ladies, and they leave. The knights draw their swords on Tannhauser, but Elizabeth, the chaste Elizabeth, shields him with her own body. She pleads that he could be given another chance. At length, Tannhauser comes out of his daydream and realizes his sin. The Landgrave demands that he shall make a pilgrimage to Rome. Full of fervor for his mission, Tannhauser bids farewell to Elizabeth and sets out. Poor Wolfram, knowing at last how much Elizabeth loves Tannhauser, in spite of all his faults, he puts aside all thought of declaring his own affection for her. He goes off with her to greet Tannhauser when the pilgrims return. Now, musically, this is brilliant. You've already heard it in the overture. Now you'll hear it sung, but beginning softly over the voices of Elizabeth and Wolfram as they wait in hope. The voices gradually increase until they reach full power with a sort of, how shall I say, a vocal fanfare. Then the crying strings I spoke of earlier dying away as poor Elizabeth finds that her beloved Tannhauser is not with them. Pope Urban IV, I think, has not forgiven him. But Wagner shows his genius here. He achieves a perfect balance between music and drama, and this is where he does it. The melody is based upon a common chord, followed by a triplet and the appoggiatura. Bum, 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 just a common chord, triplet, bop, 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 and a partitura, bum, bottom. So with these meager devices, listen to what Wagner can achieve, and he can achieve this.
Yeah.
When Tannhauser does arrive, he is in rags, completely without hope. He calls upon Venus to help, but just when he would put himself in her power, voices are heard revealing that Elizabeth is dead, a broken heart. Oh, broken hearts, wouldn't opera be dull without them? Then a torchlit procession, Wagner loved these, comes bearing the body of Elizabeth. Tannhauser bends over her and takes a last farewell, and his soul, saved by the prayers of the chaste Elizabeth, falls lifeless. Now, let's finally listen to Wolfram's baritone voice. At this point of the drama, Elizabeth has gone away in despair at the non-appearance of Tannhauser. Night is falling. He sees in the darkness a dark symbol of impending doom. He tries to shake off his depression by singing and playing on his harp. O Star of Eve is his love song for Elizabeth, the girl he could never have. The melody is built upon a descending chromatic scale, which can't help but weep. So on that sad note, I must leave you till we meet again next week. So until then, I wish you all, wherever you may be, a very good night. Good night.
Aspects of Opera was presented by Ted Courtney and produced by John Hughes. Next week, Ted explores Gounod's Faust.